tell you that as a result of your many, many letters, Neil Levang made a recording of Ghost Riders in the Sky. It has just been released, so we're going to ask Neil to play his recording arrangement.
Well, 9:57 p.m. on the East Coast. I'm usually home. I got 3 minutes left to eat everything I can. Not tonight. It's the weekend. It's a Saturday night, as the Misfits are telling you right now. A beautiful Saturday night hymn. And what are we going to be doing tonight? Whoa. Well, I've got a nice citrus mint hookah packed here. And whereas life, this studio, this building is teeming with life, it is me and my cousin Sheri here in the studio having a good time so far. Sheri, how you feeling?
I'm feeling great. Hello.
Hello.
Hello to all the Franklies.
Yes. Yes.
Love the Franklies.
I know. We're back in New York and having a good time. It's our first weekend back in New York. And tonight is a really wonderful event because I've been waiting to interview Sheri, this man, for a long time. I've listened to so many of his interviews. Chief among them is his time that he spent on Art Bell's show. Most recently, Midnight in the Desert. But it's Andrew Basiago, and we have, we're about to be taken for a journey.
I'd never heard of him, and I listened to that thing today. Wow.
Yeah.
Just a lot of thoughts.
I said, take a listen to this.
It's crazy.
Listen to this, Sheri. Get acquainted. Get some questions in your mind. Where are we going?
I mean, he blew Art Bell's mind, so.
Well, hey, here we go. It's late night talk radio over here as well. We are listening on different devices. It's not necessarily over the airwaves, but one day that would be a great thing to do this over the airwaves. But tonight it's just you at home, we over here, and Andrew Basiago is going to be on the show with us in about 15 minutes. We're going to give him a call. He's on Pacific Coast time, so it's even more convenient for him since it's not too late, and we can take him for as long as he will stay with us. And he has a lot to say, and he is, if you want to know, once again, Andrew Basiago, an American lawyer, writer. I spoke with him earlier on today, so we really got this bio down.
Ran for president. Right?
Ran for president in 2016.
Wish
writer.
I knew that.
I know. Who did know? There was 2016 was a little bit nuts. Writer, public speaker, media personality, presidential candidate, best known for serving as the U.S. Chrononaut.
Wow.
In Project Pegasus. We're going to start off, what the hell is Project Pegasus? We're going to get into that. He's going to bring us through the whole thing, because his father was a major part of that. And he was only a child when he started traveling through time, chronovising on behalf of the U.S. government, and then he was there with Project Pegasus during the advent of time travel, at least on a United States government level. I have so many questions about the real advent and what the hell is going on there, but also Project Mars.
Yeah, I had questions about that too.
That's the advent of interdimensional travel.
Do you remember when Disney had a ride about Mars, and basically it was a centrifuge and everybody got sick on it?
No.
Yeah.
Is it almost like Starship 3000 at Playland, where you just stand and get...
No, this was like, it mimicked what it would be like to travel to Mars, and I didn't want to do the centrifuge, but everybody that came out of it, I did the easy route, which was basically sitting there watching a movie in a tiny claustrophobic room, but the... Yeah, they had to close it down because everybody got sick.
Oh, well, hey, maybe we can ask him about that.
Yeah.
Hey, well, it's all going to come up, and I wonder how sick he got. I mean, there's a lot to say here, a lot to do. Also, for what it's worth, Abe Sinclair is in the background and around here, and he's going to be along for the ride as well. I don't know if he pops in or, hey, Abe, you there?
Hi, Abe.
I'm not gonna interrupt things and just
Well, he's not gonna hear you from Discord, but for now you can. What are you most excited about tonight?
I think this is as far down the rabbit hole as probably top three of all time, quite frankly, guests. And I'm just excited because I've listened to Basiago now going on 10 years plus.
Oh, by the way, it's Basiago.
Basiago.
I've been adding a little bit more of an Italian twist to it for a long time.
Cheese.
Yes, but this is a Polish Eastern European name. He corrected me on that. I said, well, I have a little bit of an Italian bias over here. I'm sorry, Andrew. But I also would like to give a very big shout out and a thank you to Aaron Moriarty, who is the host of Truth Quest. He helped me book Andrew. He's good friends with Andrew. He affectionately calls him Andy. And he gets a very well-deserved production credit for this broadcast engagement on this Saturday night in September. So, man, we got physical time travel. We've got chronovising, remote viewing. Of course, there is the
Barry Sotero connection.
A little Barry Sotero connection.
Mm-hmm.
I can't wait to get to
in
that.
A Gettysburg picture.
Right.
This is the famous Andrew Basiago picture of him in Gettysburg. That's him. When he was...
He looks out of place.
A little out of place, of
Big
course.
Big old shoes.
A fuzzy face.
So it just occurred to me, one thing you can ask is the connection to Stranger Things, and if he knew or saw anything about that, and how that associates with the Montauk. That was supposedly based off the whole Montauk Monster, Philadelphia Experiment.
Yes.
Which was the premise to his Project Pegasus.
I wanted to ask about that, because that's what I'm saying. The advent, when we talk about advent of time travel, teleportation, dimension hopping, I think of Montauk. Then again, that's more so 70s, 80s, whatnot, and that's a continuation of Philadelphia, which everybody said that's during World War II, which was running parallel supposedly to the Manhattan Project. So what is the divider? What is that divider line? And where does one start? Where does one begin? But we're going to get it all tonight, because he is full of information. He has told this story many times before, and it's so full of detail, and it never wavers. Nothing ever changes. It's incredible. So,
it's incredible he's still around and not a major target.
See, that's another question that always must be asked. It will always must be asked.
Uh-oh.
So that's what we'll get into. Let me read a little bit to you. This is from a New Earth Media article about Project Pegasus, time travel and teleportation that actually references Basiago. According to several reports and eyewitness accounts, the United States government achieved time travel and teleportation back in the late 1960s. Events of what took place throughout the late 60s, throughout the 1980s, in a program called Project Pegasus seem quite astonishing. Most people reading the information I am posting here simply will not believe it to be truth. When you look back, you would think that this technology was not even possible during that time period, but we are forgetting a very key aspect of what supposedly took place back then. According to many reliable sources, humanity was in the midst of exchanging technologies with an advanced species. Now, I want to know, are we talking interdimensional species, races, during this time? I don't know. It'll be great to get that answered as well. So it is conceivably possible to develop these technologies from a race of ETs thousands, if not millions of years ahead of us in evolution. My question is always, what do we have to offer? What do we have to barter with a civilization that is hundreds of thousands, if not millions of years ahead of us? Why would they even see us as worthy trading partners? So that's all. Always.
The human spirit. I think that's what it's all about, our creativity.
We just have such great Broadway. We have good visual arts. Who can do without that? Actually,
a lot of great bands.
That too. But you guys remember Riley Martin, who would go on the Stern show. They talk about his interactions with the Viavians.
No.
Abe, you know Riley Martin, right?
I don't think I'm as familiar. No. You might refresh me.
You don't remember Riley Martin?
I don't think so.
Anyway, he would talk about his experiences up on alien craft and being shown the ropes of how the universe really is and all that. And he would always rely or come back around to how we were admired greatly for our ability to compose music and to create beautiful works of art and how expressive we are. Of course, we have a lot of vices and pitfalls and all that, too. So, anyway, it's going to create a wonderful tapestry of conversation tonight.
Yeah.
That's what we have.
Lots of Vatican talk.
Got to talk about the Vatican as well.
Yeah, I want to know if he's seen the picture of Jesus.
The one, the chronovisor, right?
Yeah.
And that's another reason why I say, when you say advent of one technology or another, then where does the long fabled Vatican chronovisor come into the mix? What kind of events did he, as a child, have any sort of autonomy in requesting something he'd like to see, or was it always just very mission based? The butterfly effect.
Well, it sounds like they gave the kids some vacations and some, some extra things for doing the job.
Can't go to school today. I'm going to prehistoric time.
Yeah. I'm going to go see some dinosaurs.
Barack got to be the president.
That's right. Barack got to be the president. For everybody
who
doesn't know,
winner.
We're going to get around to that, too. Andrew Basiago has been very forthright for years about how one of his jump room partners was Barack Obama. That Barack Obama
was a child, right?
He was a roommate.
I believe
it was
as a child.
Yeah.
Roommate.
Yeah.
That's a big,
So there's a lot to unpack here. Hopefully we can get a good amount of information out and discussed and floating about before midnight, because that is my hard stop here. I would love to have him back on for another one of these Saturday night schmoozes, because...
Well, I hope he can tell us how it kind of ties into today, because that must have been a long time ago, right, that interview?
Yeah.
How many years? Maybe 20?
Oh, which one?
The Art Bell one.
That was 2013 or 15.
Oh, okay.
13 or...
I hadn't heard of what he's done since the presidential thing. So I would love to kind of get a little catch up and see how, because he was pretty intent, and that was his main focus when I lost track of him, was the presidential run. And then I got lost in the everything that happened since then, and kind of haven't been caught up, so it's going to be a riveting night.
Yeah, I agree. And just as far as everybody else out there goes, I understand you're going to be teeming with questions, and you're many of you are going to be rigidly skeptical, and that's fine, too. You have to. You're going to be hearing things tonight that are you may have never heard before, and you just might not be able to swallow the whole pill. So whatever,
just have some fun. Let's have some fun.
Yes, exactly.
Night.
And send in. You can send in questions either through the super chats. Hopefully, I can get through them, get a few of those in. But it's going to be a little bit harder to do that. But anything that comes in that does not get answered tonight, I am going to start a little bit of a repository on all these questions so that we can be armed with new follow-ups the next time that he comes on, which I hope happens. But one night at a time, and we're going to give him a call in about 5 minutes. So other than that, I know that we got a pretty brand new snazzy-looking pilled.net, which is filtering down to quitefrankly.tv. I hope everybody's enjoying themselves over there. People are having a good time on Twitch, Foxhole, Rumble, YouTube, Rockfin. Theta is giving us a little bit of problems tonight. I still cannot connect to Theta. So everybody on Theta needs to find a secondary place to watch. And hopefully that all gets cleared up by Monday. But
how many people watch from Theta?
Honestly, I think the most I've seen there is 13. So
Look, all 13 of you, head on over to quitefrankly.tv. We have a brand new formatted chat and outlook on the whole deal. So, like, come in there and let's look at the chat. It's looking really smooth and awesome. And by the way, I'm going to be looking at the chats tonight if there's any pressing questions that looks like need to be asked. So I'll be assisting and representing the Franklies. If there's some good questions in the chat room, then shine some light on you guys as well.
That's great. So we have...
You're so good, Abe.
No, Abe is always on top of it.
You are.
No.
Come on, you guys.
Oh, us. Am I right?
Yeah. Yeah, so what was the other thing I was going to say? I was going to say something else when it...
Sheri ruined it.
Sorry.
I don't know where we were going with all that. I was doing updates on...
We got into Theta.
Theta. I call Theta the jacuzzi. It's pretty much the jacuzzi of the Quite Frankly broadcast experiences, because it is, I think that's where Jerry Coogan hangs out. Nikki definitely hangs out there, though she's in multiple chat rooms at once. And a few other people, Nighthawk, and I know the regulars over there. Anyway.
Coogan and the jacuzzi.
That's it. We have the jacuzzi on Theta. We've got the... of course, Twitch, they are a culture unto themselves. They are very, very proud over there on Twitch. DLive is the scrum. DLive are the nipple-obsessed people. They're obsessed with nipples, but they are definitely a force of their own. YouTube, it is just that rock where everybody comes in, comes and goes. And
Crack rock.
and then Rockfin. Rockfin is another one. It's a little bit more. It's a giant pool. It's a public pool, not necessarily a jacuzzi. There's more people in there that a jacuzzi could hold.
Plenty of chlorine.
Yes.
I've been wanting to hang out where the lone wolves go. Where's that? That's Theta?
I have been encouraging people to make their own internet chat rooms. To make their own, like, private room. I don't care where the hell it is. The show is easy to access live no matter where the hell it is. But take your faves, take all of your favorite people, your inner circles, and start your own chats. That would be awesome, too, to hear from certain, new chat rooms I don't even know exist, or, a Frankly chat from some obscure IRC website. Who the hell knows? That'd be nice.
Yeah.
So...
that's what I'm doing.
Yeah, get creative. All right, it's 10:14. That means we're calling up Andrew Basiago, and we're going to start this one off. And I don't know. I wouldn't say buckle up. I'd say unbuckle. And let's just get knocked around a little bit. This is going to be great. Let's do it, and we're calling him now. Hello, Mr. Basiago. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Frank. Good to be on the show.
Oh, it's wonderful to have you on. Thank you for being here tonight. I think I've told you a number of times. We've been all waiting for this a long time. And another thank you to Aaron Moriarty for making this happen. He's a real kind friend of the show. So if you're feeling well, I'd love to just jump right in.
I am. So fire away.
Okay. So first thing, for an audience that is comprised of many people who have never heard of you and your story and your work before, let's just start from the beginning. Could you please begin by describing, in your own words and your own experience, how Project Pegasus came to be and how you became such an integral part in its experiments?
Well, it really had its origins in the now very famous overflight of our nation's capital in July of 1952. My late father, Raymond Basiago, was then working at Oak and Knight in Paramus, New Jersey, and a bird colonel showed up at his desk in October of 1952 and ordered him to report to the Curtiss Wright Aeronautical Company facility in Woodridge, New Jersey, the next Monday. There, he designed the metal alloy by which the Ram jet would be built to chase the ET craft away from our planet. Now, they knew from that event forward, not necessarily the Roswell incident of July of 1947, but that July 1952 overflight, that the ET craft were not only traveling at incredible speeds that we could not match. I think the nine of them were clocked at something like 7,000 miles per hour at Langley Air Force Base in Virginia, where the CIA was located, still is. And they also realized that they were teleporting around the sky. They were just blinking off and then immediately appearing somewhere else, or at least seemingly immediately or instantaneously. So during the 50s and 60s, DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, that my dad was affiliated with, really with all other U.S. intel and military departments and agencies, was working on the teleportation activities of Nikola Tesla that he left evidence of upon his death in New York City on January 7th, 1943. So, for example, after working on the ramjet from 1952 to 55 at Curtiss Wright, my dad was hired by the Thomas A. Edison Research Labs that had been founded by Neil T. Williams at West Orange, New Jersey. And essentially what my dad did during those 8 years was solve a lot of high-end math problems for different microcircuitry that became sort of caught up in what would ultimately become the computer age. A lot of those devices were bought up by Robert Noyce and became Intel Corporation. But a major thing my dad was doing at the Edison Labs, as it was called, which were not the original Thomas A. Edison Labs, they were actually one door away from Edison's original laboratory there in West Orange, was repeat Nikola Tesla's teleportation experiments. And then during the 50s or 60s, when they set up one of those devices that was labeled energetic array in Nikola Tesla's paperworks that he left upon his death in 1943, they turned the device on, and a field of radiant energy began cascading down these two elliptical-shaped booms, or armatures, and a technician walked through that field of energy to pick up a screwdriver across the shop floor. But he tumbled to Africa. It took him about 6 weeks or 6 months to get home. His supervisor thought he had been disintegrated. So when that technician at Curtiss Wright showed up, he told his supervisor what happened, and they realized, my God, Tesla left a teleporter upon his death. So in early 1968, when I was 6.5 years old, my dad had me go up with him to Curtiss Wright. We went to Building 68. There on the shop floor was this elliptical-shaped set of booms. They were about, each boom was like shaped like sort of like a battleship gray elephant tusk. They were about 8 feet high and about 10 feet across on the floor. And when you stood back by about, let's say, 10 feet, it sort of looked like a cascading water and kind of a public water sculpture. But when you went up to about a foot, it looked like raster on early television screen in that black and white snow pattern, with these little squiggles of bluish green light going back and forth across that field at like 3-inch intervals. And my dad explained that he would hold my hand, and on the count of three, we would leap through that field of energy. So we practiced a couple of times, and then he had one of the technicians turn on the device. And when we jumped through that field of energy, precisely what he said was going to happen, happened. We found ourselves in what's come to be understood as a vortal tunnel through time-space. It looked basically like an oblate triangular tunnel of bluish white light. And just as my father had predicted, we would, in several seconds, find ourselves on a hillside somewhere else in the country. But before then, a couple seconds before then, what he predicted would happen, or might happen, did happen. He was sort of pulled through the wall of the vortal tunnel. And I thought, my God, my dad has disappeared. But then we both arrived on the hillside he had predicted, somewhere else in the country. And then I later found out it was the state capitol grounds in Santa Fe, New Mexico, a distance of 2,005 miles from Wood Ridge, New Jersey, which we reached in about 5 seconds. And he then got a state automobile, New Mexico state vehicle, and we drove over to the Los Alamos National Labs, and we met with Dr. Harold M. Agnew when he was the director of the W Division at LANL, the Los Alamos National Labs. Agnew was probably the quintessential Project Manhattan physicist. He had been a part of all critical stages of the, you know, the testing, the design, and the ultimate test explosion of the atomic bomb. And he was then the head of the W Division, the weapons division. And it was there ensconced in the military-industrial complex, as President Eisenhower called it, that time travel was sort of initiated, because the first thing they were working on was Tesla teleportation. He had labeled it an energetic array, but they began calling it a Tesla energetic array, or Tesseract, which Madeline L'Engle was encouraged to pick up in her book A Wrinkle in Time as a form of what my dad described as what they were calling disinformation. So that was one of the first devices that we did. And my dad basically took me to that meeting with Dr. Agnew. And when he asked in regard to me, how old, you know, my dad said, Harold asked my dad, how was your trip, Ray? And he said, fine and fast. And Dr. Agnew looked up and said, oh, did you take the teleporter? And my dad said, yep. And so did my number three son, Andrew. And he looked over at me. And Dr. Agnew looked over at me as I was sitting there next to my dad and said, in regard to me, how old? And my dad and I both said, six. So that's an important data point, because that establishes that the man who was then the director of the W Division at LANL, who would become the director of the Los Alamos National Labs from roughly 1970 to, I think, 78, was asking my father about the, had he taken the teleporter. When my dad said, you know, that we had, and Dr. Agnew asked me, you know, asked my dad and I how old, and we said six, my dad let out some rope and then said, have you taken it yet, Harold? And Agnew said, no, but I want to. Now look, if the man who then became the director of our biggest bomb lab in the United States of America had not yet tried teleportation, it had to be a new application in applied quantum physics in the atomic research community, which is what that sort of area of our government was known as. And at the same time, we know that our teleportation to Santa Fe had to have been done between September of 1967 and September of 1968, because I was born in September of 1961. So that memory allows us to kind of contextualize the advent of teleportation secretly by the U.S. government, and then when they began to manipulate when we would arrive at our destination in the past or future teleportation-based time travel. And then they began to involve me in other forms of time travel.
Okay.
Eight modalities in total.
Eight modalities. Now, before we get into that, we're talking about teleportation. The first question I have is, how did they start? How was location? You said that the first guy to cross Tesla's lab or cross the lab while Tesla's technology was being tinkered with to pick up a screwdriver somewhere ended up in Africa, and he wasn't heard from for weeks and or months.
Right.
And then, so how did it become that if you are in New Jersey, you knew, they knew for a fact you were going to show up in a specific location in New Mexico? Is this something that is just technologically needs to be done from one stargate to the other, or
well,
are you riding through?
Yeah, Frank, it was an emergent disruptive technology that when they set up the Tesla device, all they knew is it said energetic array. They had no idea what it did. And in fact, the first Americans to Tesla teleport were a group of Navy enlisted personnel who asphyxiated because the vortal tunnel they set up was too long. Then they began working with foreign children that they would bring to our country and use in Defense Department experiments. I was in the third group. So by the time I started jumping through that near, you know, the beginning of 1968, they had worked out all the kinks in teleportation. So my answer is that they were finding out how to set both the size of the vortal tunnel and hence the destination and calculate, can somebody get through it with enough of the oxygen they push into that vortal tunnel just with their body. But then they found out, well, wait a minute, if we manipulate this part of this device, oh my God, we can have somebody arrive in what we call the past or the future. Because a number of things that Project Pegasus proved is the so-called time-space continuum. Everything occurs when it occurs to us because our perception is focused on that time and place, what I call, you know, a time place in time space. But it's all there. The past, present, future exist all the time simultaneously. We just perceive it from our time place, our position in time space. And that was true of many of these devices. They were working out, well, just how does this work? What are we actually dealing with here? And it was an emergent set of technologies. Now, they had kind of made it safe, but it was still new, dangerous, and experimental when we children were involved. And I was not the only American child. There was like 140. So there were 139 others my age, born roughly between 1958 and 62. I was like the second youngest, born in September 61, I was told by one of the physicists at LANL. So they were working with us, and they were making it safe, but then they wanted to use children to find out, well, let's say if we have the family of the president teleport with the president, the vice president, whatever, let's have these, you know, these first families of America, let's find out what it will do to children if they teleport. So they had a number of goals in using kids in the program.
When you talk about the advent of time technology, whether it just be teleportation or, as we'll get into, moving into the past, moving into the future, or just observing one or the other, how do we work out anybody who's been interested in this kind of stuff has learned over the years about, say, the Philadelphia experiment, which predates the 1960s, but we all heard was teleportation based and whatnot. So why do you assert that the advent was in the 60s? What should we know about Philadelphia? That
that's always a critical question. I'm talking about the Tesla energetic array that was set up in building 68 at Curtis Wright Aeronautical Company facility in Wood Ridge. Something that later got captioned under the evolving sort of mythification of the Philadelphia experiment happened, but it happened a number of months after Tesla died, like in August of 43. It did not involve the Eldridge. It involved the USS Martha's Vineyard. It was not in the Philadelphia Naval Yard, but in Long Island Sound. It did not involve radar invisibility of the Eldridge, as was told in numerous books, articles, and even a feature film. It involved Tesla teleportation of the Martha's Vineyard. And at the helm of that vessel, during that experiment into Tesla teleportation, were not Einstein or John von Neumann or Tesla and others who have been linked to the so-called Philadelphia experiment, but the real Philadelphia experiment, which took place in Long Island Sound, involved J. Robert Oppenheimer and Edward Teller at the helm. So after the war, and by the way, because it wasn't Tesla teleportation, there was a massive discharge of electrostatic energy. That was even a danger when I was teleporting in the shop unit of the Tesla teleporter. I couldn't even bring standard American coins in my pocket. And one time when one of my classmates did, it literally started getting agitated and tore a rip in his pants. And almost, my dad said if that had hit either of us, it would have killed us. So that did happen. There wasn't a massive discharge of electrostatic energy with the Martha's Vineyard, but there wasn't a group of sailors fused into the ship. There was one sailor who, when the ship was brought back, not from Norfolk, Virginia, but from Newport News, Virginia, was impaled on the column of the splash cowling in front of the captain's helm inside of the Martha's Vineyard. But because there were so many naval witnesses, and because that experiment in Long Island Sound linked Tesla teleportation and the very Los Alamos physicists who had built and, you know, had designed and built and achieved the atomic bomb, and they wanted to keep the emerging teleportation and time travel secret, the Office of Naval Intelligence scripted the Philadelphia experiment that has come down to us. So I'm not saying this was the first experiment in teleportation, even by Tesla. Apparently, Tesla may have even been involved in the Kearsarge experiment in the late 30s. I'm just saying that the unit that I was exposed to was that shop floor model at Curtis Wright.
Okay. So then we'll just move along to the different types of abilities of this technology, because again we're talking about teleportation. You must know, obviously, the long fabled rumors of the chronovisor hidden at the Vatican. That's something that I've read was actually being worked on from the 60s until the 90s by a Father Ernetti. What do you know about the chronovisor from the Vatican? Because I know the Vatican is huge with all these types of experimentations. And then maybe get into the difference between teleportation, chronovising, being able to, and not yes. actually being able to physically go someplace. And then we'll go to the actual jumping from past to future to present and the nature of time itself. But first, chronovising. What can you tell us about that?
Frank, I love this question, and I love how on top of the facts, the critical facts, you are. And I love, as somebody who grew up in an Italian neighborhood in New Jersey, to share this with an Italian-American. There was a Vatican provenance, rather, of chronovision, il chronovisore, as they say in Italian. The Father Pellegrino Ernetti and Father Agostino Gemelli were working at the Catholic University of Milan in Italy in the 1940s. And they were trying to understand why Gregorian chants, as played by Vatican prelates who were musicologists or singers, musicians, had certain properties, like certain spiritual reassurance, certain healing properties, and so forth. And they designed a specialized microphone to split the signals, and they changed the microphone, and something that made a little technical change to it, and something that Father Agostino Gemelli, also known as Pier Maria Gemelli, I guess that was his priestly name, but he'd been born Agostino Gemelli, something that Father Gemelli's father said to him in childhood when his nickname for his young Italian son was zucchini. And they looked at each other and said, my God, we have a window to the past. So they got with Enrico Fermi, the most prominent Italian physicist, who later would go on to work on the atomic bomb at the University of Chicago with a graduate student in physics, a prized pupil named, guess what, Harold M. Agnew. And there in the 40s and early 50s, Ernetti, Gemelli, and Fermi developed a flat-screened television-like chronovisor. Now, I know that the Vatican province told by individuals like Father Francois Brunet is true, because when I was at the chronovisor array that I was using initially to get to the past, but later the future, on Project Pegasus, 1970, 71, 72, I was at the chronovisor array in Morristown in the Performing Arts Center there. You might want to go over there to New Jersey and take a look at that. And it's still there. And it was sort of a building from the 1870s that they were reconditioning. But that's where the chronovisor was on the stage of that Performing Arts Center in Morristown. And one of the technicians said to me, Andy, that Catholic priest in the back of the room, that's Father Ernetti, one of the inventors of the chronovisor. I just wanted you to know that that was happening, because there he is, and here you are. So I what I wanted to share with you, and I think it's neat that I'm sharing it with an Italian-American, is that that story is true, and I can bear eyewitness testimony to its truth. The idea of a Project Looking Glass developing the chronovisor is not true. My dad even said to me when I was a teenager, when we were talking about the program, and I was no longer in Project Pegasus, you know, son, with a lot of these devices, the Vatican gave it to our government, like our Navy, and I know they did with the chronovisor, and then they passed it on to Bell Labs. So what apparently happened at Bell Labs was that they turned the chronovisor from a flat-screen television screen in which Ernetti and Gemelli were claiming they had, for example, images of the crucifixion of Jesus and some ancient Roman poem that they had the full lyrics of, into a cubicle, a hologram of light. And when that light was brought down around us on the stage of the chronovisor, we went to that initially, that past event. But I was in the first group of U.S. chrononauts who on November 5th of 1971 went forward in time via chronovisor. So the Vatican provenance of the chronovisor is the truth about that particular time travel device.
Okay, this is it's pretty incredible stuff here. And so let's talk a little bit more about that. Can you please explain the functionality of the chronovisor from a, you are in New Jersey, you are from there gazing into the past, and then we'll talk about the actual taking a person physically and bringing them to a place. But I would love to know a little bit more about the gazing into the past or future. For example, I know about whenever somebody learns about the legends of the Vatican chronovisor, they are going to invariably learn about how they went, how the Vatican went, Ermetti went and observe the crucifixion. How does one focus this on a location like Golgotha or something to that effect? How are you able to focus in on a time and a place and be able to view it from your remote location? Then we can talk about actual being there.
Well, I came into that technical development in 1970. My dad even described how they were using an eight-sided bismuth crystal and putting an EM signal through that, and that was causing that cube of light to pop out on the stage. So between the 40s, when they developed essentially two-dimensional chronovision, to the time I was in when third and fourth dimensional chronovision were being perfected, and even they were experimenting with how kids would respond to being chronovised, they had found a way to focus on a particular time place, a particular point, if you will, in time space. How they did it, I don't know, because I wasn't one of the technicians on the project. I wasn't an engineer, a physicist, a mathematician. I was a chrononaut. I was a time-space explorer. And one of America's earliest, certainly in childhood. But I do know that when they created when they propagated a past event, let's say the assassination of Lincoln, which they sent me to, if I was standing outside that hologram, I saw it, and they even used the phrase a looking glass. See, kids, this is a looking glass into past events. In fact, the first chronovisor image we were shown was a beautiful Tudor castle in England in like the year 1500 with this stablemate in a gray brocaded shirt, like half shirt, and gray tights and gray curled up boots, leading a gray mare diagonally across the grounds of this beautiful Tudor mansion in England. And we were just amazed. We were looking in at a looking glass of some location in England around 1500. But what they then showed us, it was Jack Pruitt, who would later become the research director of Project Montauk, explained to us that if we were sitting on the stage beyond the blue line on the floor and the hologram was propagated, we would spontaneously go to that location. So when they used that hologram on people, when they focused it around living human beings, both adult and children, they found that that person would subjectively go to that time place, that location, if you will, in time space. But because when they used an adult, the breathing, the footfall, a cough, a sneeze, a comment, a laugh, whatever, would cause the hologram to go on the fritz, like an early television screen, they decided to use children. So in that sense, we were necessities in going initially to the past via il chronovisor, the chronovisor. In the case of, we were necessities. We were also experimentees because they wanted to test the effect on children, as they did with all these devices. We were also viewees in the sense that they knew that children had more keen and accurate perceptions when they were time traveling. And we were sanies, as I call it, because we weren't going crazy when we would move back and forth from different points in time space. So how they identified the point, I don't know. But I think it's kind of moot, because whatever point in time space they propagated, again, in this sort of mini holographic universe inside that hologram on the stage of the device, whoever was in it when that was propagated went to that past location. Now, if we were there for any of us, adult or children, but particularly children, after they had to use us as necessities in the program, if we were in for 15 minutes, the hologram would just collapse and we were back on the stage of the device back in Morristown or the one over in Curtis Wright in Woodridge or whatever. There was also a chronovisor array there that we were using. But if we were in the hologram for more than 15 minutes, a density effect would occur, and we were stuck in that place in time space, and they had to insert kind of a soccer goal like portal that we were trained to run to. And when we did, we found ourselves in this dark tunnel in thicker and thicker sand, and we were taught how and shown how it was the back of like a dinosaur tunnel, like an amusement park ride, if you will, at, we believe it was Bertram's Island in New Jersey. And from there we would be bused back to usually Morristown. So they were able to not only isolate a point in time space with the chronovisor, and be able to call up, for example, I saw a film of scenes of Jesus of Nazareth's ministry and crucifixion, and my dad spoke of the scenes that his team had gathered of Jesus's resurrection. So they were getting scenes that we would look on as looking glasses when we weren't in the hologram, but when they chose to focus the hologram around us, we subjectively went to that past location in time.
And
in
when
space.
When you say you're in there in this hologram, because when somebody thinks of hologram, they think of there's an Elvis Presley show at Radio City Music Hall, and they're going to project a 3D image on the stage. You're not talking at this point now when you're subjectively bounced into this this scene, you're not talking about a scene from, say, A Christmas Carol where Ebenezer Scrooge is observing Fezziwig's Christmas party with no interaction. You're just observe. You're able to talk and interact with people and things there?
Yes, and in fact, all of these scientific truths were shared with us in learning chapters, you know, learning lesson plans, if you will, in a speed learning program developed by a CIV, Servicio Intelligencia Vaticano. It was on the screen. And they were science, the history of science and the history of society from the time of Galileo Galilei, 1450. So I picked up all this scientific knowledge. But when I say hologram, you know, in answer to your question, Frank, I'm remembering that we went to a museum in, like, I think it was in Newark, and before we even were chronovised, we saw images of, like, standard holograms of, like, Frank Sinatra singing and Muhammad Ali boxing, and I don't know, maybe it was George Washington laying the, you know, the cornerstone of the Capitol or something in 1793. I don't remember what the third was. You know, it might have been, I don't know, Babe Ruth hitting a baseball. And so they were just showing us what a hologram was in the conventional sense. And then they explained to us that what we're doing in the chronovisor is creating essentially another hologram, but it's not just a hologram image, it's a recapitulation of a location in the quantum hologram, the hologram in which we find ourselves. You know, it's being propagated by a device. We're calling it the Matrix. They shared that with me when they were spinning us to induce out-of-body experiences. And I got to this black wall-like area that I couldn't get past. And the woman who interviewed me after that time-space probe said, yes, Andy, other people are reporting that. We think it's the infrastructure propagating the hologram in which we find ourselves. We're calling it the Matrix. Now, that was after Tesla teleport, no, after remote viewing. The second form of time travel I did was just spinning to induce out-of-body experiences. And I've taken accounts from people who've had accidental spinnings where they've had non-local events happen in their lives, like going back 30 years and so forth. So we knew what a hologram was because they had taken us to that museum in New Jersey to look at standard holograms. But no, they were using hologram in terms of an emission of moving light recapitulating initially a past and then future events, so that if we were in that hologram, we went there because of the time-space continuum. When you propagate an area of that time-space continuum in a new location, they found that what's going on there in the total quantum hologram is recapitulated at the local level. And so we were going there. And it was dangerous. I mean, a couple of times I got stuck in the past. One time in, like, the Five Points neighborhood of New York City that was featured in that, I think it was a Steven Spielberg movie, like The Gangs of New York. And I was among a bunch of young toughs, about 10 or 12 street urchins living with one Irish lady in this filthy tenement. And I was terrified because I didn't think I was going to get home. Another time, I was driven home from my elementary school after arriving back via teleportation at Curtis Wright. And I went to my front door and some strange lady answered the door and said she lived there, not my beloved mother. So I was actually in another dimension. So Project Pegasus was doing very advanced time travel probes, and I was caught up in that as a young child. I received specialized training just to deal with the deracinating effects of time travel.
Okay, so here's where a few things come up for me. Now, I got to ask you about the kinds of, obviously, first, you're just trying to, they're just trying to see how this thing works and the effect that it's having on people who are actually doing all this this traveling. But you bring up the concept of, or the situation of being stuck. Now, astronauts, as we learn as so young, that if something really goes wrong, badly, you're not getting back home from whatever mission you're on, that astronauts are given right. some kind of cyanide capsule so they can just kill themselves and not have to go through one way or if they're stuck. And then, you know, here you are. How do they prepare not only just people, but children for being stuck in a potentially forever, stuck in a time that is that could be hundreds of years disconnected from where you were born, with not only yeah. not only no one you know, but possibly, depending on what your mission is, no one around you even speaking a modern language? What was all the protocols for something like that?
Well, sometimes they would dress us in appropriate period clothing. But basically, you know, I was involved in these eight modalities: remote viewing, spinning to induce out-of-body experiences, and then the Montauk chair, and then Tesla teleportation, and then Chronovision, the Stargate, the plasma confinement chamber, and so forth. So what they were doing was an integrated program that they give in these classified defense-related research and development programs. There were something like 50,000 people in my generation caught up in these programs. You basically, we had the specialized lesson plans in Galileo, this sort of DARPA and Ivy League and CIV, or Servicio Intelligencia Vaticano, specialized chapters, like here's Chronovision, you know, here's Tesla teleportation, here's a chapter on Tesla, here's a chapter on T. Thompson Brown, here's a chapter on Walter Russell explaining the difference between positive and negative electricity and so forth. So they were giving us all this historical and science training. We were all high IQ and highly psychic children. In fact, we all began initially as remote viewers for the Office of Naval Intelligence. And then they began dropping in these other lesson plans and then gradually taking us off campus to these defense contractor locations throughout New Jersey. And then those would take us to New Mexico, sometimes Ohio, because if the teleportation failed, we would show up near the Swage Lock company headquarters in Solon, Ohio, and so forth. So they just began expanding the ambit. They had specialized sort of quality circles between myself and my peers in my learning lab at my public elementary school, which is Mountview Road School. Maybe my father would give a lecture, maybe Jack Pruitt, maybe our special educator, Elaine Gallagher, maybe the special educator, Joseph Humer. There was a young man named Galen who was working with Jack Pruitt. And so they would sit around in a circle and say, okay, kids, let's talk about the Chronovisor and how it works. And they gradually brought us along with each device. And then before we did any time travel off campus at a military or defense contractor location, they would do an acclimation trip to that location. That's how I ended up meeting a 25-year-old future quite prominent broadcaster named Art Bell at ITT Defense Communications in October of 1971. And he remembered it, and we remembered meeting each other. And Art confirmed that in his interview with me on August 14th, 2015. And so we would go out to these locations and get an acclimation trip, and then on the next trip, we would travel in time. Now, how they prepared us for getting lost in time, because, you know, we were children of lost in space, you know, in terms of television, but we realized we could be lost in time. For example, when we were teleporting to Santa Fe, they had us learn the street plan to Santa Fe, but more than that, they said, children, if you jump here in 1971 and get there, let's say, in 1791 or 1931, it was always, you know, 20-year increments, because that's the basic pulse of the Earth, represented, for example, in tree ring cycles. We want you to ask a parish priest, a sheriff, a mayor, a wealthy business person, tell them that your parents have been killed traveling to New Mexico, and will they adopt you? Because kids, you have to understand that we're having you memorize the street plan of Santa Fe in case you get lost in 1971 going to that other place in space from New Jersey. But if you arrive there somewhere else in time, we will not be able to rescue you because there weren't teleporters then. You will be stuck in that past time. And so fortunately, when we jumped through the device in 1971 and got to Santa Fe in 1991, the very year when I was up in Portland, Oregon, completing my last year of my legal education at Lewis and Clark Law School in Portland, you know, a 10-year-old version of me was popping out in Santa Fe. And so I was in two places at one time in that sense. My 30-year-old self was in Portland studying law, and my 10-year-old self was in Santa Fe, arriving in 1991 when I had come from 1971. So fortunately, when that happened, we were able to get back from Sandia back to Curtis Wright, 1971, because it was in the future and the teleporters existed. But we knew from the beginning, if that had been in the opposite direction, and we had come out in 1931 or 1911, it was going to be a catastrophe. We're going to be stuck in time. Now, when we did use the chronovisor, they explained that when we first went and we were not in for 15 minutes, that density effect would not occur because we would be what Jack Pruitt called only a supraluminal superimposition on time space. And he used the example like certain ghosts are in our area of the time space continuum. Those are often residual hauntings. They are superluminal superimpositions of people who once lived on Earth. Now, some, of course, are spiritual hauntings of people still alive, or earthbound spirits. But they explained that there are residual hauntings from the past, and that's what we would look like. For example, when they sent me to visit General George Washington. But if we ever remained in for more than 15 minutes, it went from third-dimensional to fourth-dimensional chronovision, and we were actually there and had to be extracted. So we had specialized training of what to do in an emergency or a disaster on the program.
Okay.
But it wasn't complete because we knew it still didn't get us home if we were stuck too far in the past.
Well, you just brought something up that I guess this is the logical next place for me to go. And you brought up you were sent back to either be around or observe or interact with George Washington. My question is this. Anybody who has watched any kind of Hollywood production on time travel, whether it be Back to the Future, is one of those home, you know, everybody knows about that one. We always learn about the very serious situation of creating a paradox, and the butterfly effect being one of those situations where you're not necessarily coming face to face with your future self and the whole world, the whole universe exploding, but being able to even take one average person off of their daily routine by a minute will create some kind of a domino effect that could affect major portions of the world and world history. Well, can you tell us a little bit about the butterfly effect, especially if you're talking to people like, or being around people like George Washington?
Yes, the butterfly effect was sometimes manifest on Project Pegasus, just as we proved the multiverse and the time-space continuum. Now, let's reference the butterfly effect in terms of the multiverse. There were butterfly effects that I and some of the other children in the program directly witnessed, so I can just cite one of the examples I just gave of the what I call the quantum excursion, when we jumped through the teleporter in New Jersey in 1971 and came out in 1991 in Santa Fe and had to have the security director for the whole state capitol complex there contact Sandia. In fact, I pulled rank as essentially the captain of blue team and said to the assistant security chief of the Santa Fe State Capitol grounds, "No, are you the security director?" And he said, "No." And I said, "Please get him." And then I said to him, "Sir, you may not believe me, but at the end of the day, I'm 2,005 miles and 20 years from home. So please call them," namely Sandia. Okay, now, when we came back to New Jersey from that very event, two of the other children and I realized that somebody was missing. I think her name was either Megan or Heather. She had been one of the 8 to 10 kids who had jumped through at Curtis Wright and had that quantum excursion from 1971 to 1991. But then when we all spent a half hour wearing specialized equipment, including helmets and oxygen masks, to get back to New Jersey 1971, one of the children did not show up at our learning lab at Mount Tree Road School in Morris Plains ever again. So that was an example of the actual functioning of the butterfly effect. It's not axiomatic that if you, you know, go walking in Yosemite, one little piece of clover that you pick up could determine the fate of human beings or cause, you know, Sasquatch to exist in Yosemite or something. It's more like, because there's a multiverse, okay, there are entirely similar, dissimilar, and entirely dissimilar things going on at multiple data points throughout the multiverse. So let me just cite one example. A number of years ago, when some teenagers were walking up Mount Diablo in Northern California, a transformer exploded, and there was a cascade of sparks, like an umbrella of sparks up on Mount Diablo in front of them, and they saw through to a Civil War battle going on, even though there weren't any Civil War battles in California, not, you know, battles between red or between the blue Union and the gray Confederate soldiers. And so there in California, that at that time-space location, in a slightly different dimension that was focused in by the cascade of sparks, that non-local sort of event threshold of the Civil War was reaching California. So there are multiple events, both similar, dissimilar, and entirely dissimilar, going on all over the place. I mean, right now, a speech by Julius Caesar may be zipping right past our faces. In other words, there are all these multiplicity of events going on at slightly different angles. So the butterfly effect was working on Project Pegasus, but it wasn't axiomatic that a tiny little change mattered, because you had to have some kind of displacement into a slightly different dimension to either detect that or to experience that. So in other words, that poor individual who got lost probably was sent into another dimension when we either teleported. Well, it wasn't when we teleported to Santa Fe, because they took a roll and everybody was there. It was when we returned to New Jersey. That little girl was lost. And, you know, I've often thought if they do a feature film about my experiences, I even have the song that would be played for that event. She was lost in time space, or we were moved slightly by the butterfly effect into a reality where she was never born or never came to that school or was never placed in Project Pegasus. I don't know. All I know is that, yes, a small butterfly effect occurred, but was it usually still my family when I went back to our house? Yes, but one time it wasn't. It was an entirely different family living there. So that, in a sense, was the butterfly effect, in the sense that I was sent back from Sandia National Labs back to Curtis Wright, but it was my New Jersey in a different dimension.
This is my home state. This is pretty much just, it's making watching David Lynch's Twin Peaks a lot more. I'm digesting Twin Peaks a lot more now. I don't know if you ever watched that, but it's...
I did.
Yeah, yes. Especially the third season. And as you're saying this, it's making me remember something I've heard you talk about in previous interviews about your stories, where you went multiple times to places like Ford's Theater for the assassination of President Lincoln. And I remember you saying that there were very weird things that were different every time, like the person at the box office. Or talk a little bit about that. And does that have anything to do with your presence there, or is it you're just constantly going back to other dimensions that this event was playing out over and over again? And
right. Well, that kind of contextualizes both the multiverse and the butterfly effect much more accurately. At the Surrealist Cultural Center, which is kind of an early WPA Depression era community center. On the left side of Highway 14, before you make a right into Cerrillos or go left around the curve to Madrid, New Mexico, there was in the summer of 1971, and by that I mean when my dad and I teleported to 1971, spent the whole summer there, and then teleported home at the end of that summer so as to arrive like 15 minutes after we had left. So I call it my first summer of 1971. I had two summers of 70, 71, 73 accessed from fall of 71, and 72. And it took me literally decades to de-link and figure out those displacements in time space. But we were at the Cerrillos Cultural Center in summer of 71, the first summer of 71, and they had explained how they were sending me to Ford's Theater to get behind the Lincoln's balcony seating and see who shot Mr. Lincoln, President Lincoln. I believe they had a concern that it was Major Henry Rathbone sitting nearby him, because later, after witnessing the murder of our great president, Abraham Lincoln, he would go on to kill the woman sitting next to him, Clara Harris. So I think they were concerned that Major Rathbone may have been suffering from PTSD from the war as a Union major, or was angry at Lincoln for dawdling during that first year when he was just really asking McClellan, well, if you aren't going to use the U.S. Army, may I? You know, Lincoln was kind of blowing it there during the first year of the Civil War. So Rathbone may have been angry at him for the death of all of his, probably his high school classmates. You know, in many battles of the Civil War, half of a particular high school would die together in one battle, because all of the state and local soldiers were going there with their peers from their high schools and so forth, from their hometowns in particular states. So I think they had a fear that it wasn't John Wilkes Booth. It was either Lincoln committing suicide, Mrs. Lincoln killing him because he was having an extramarital affair or something, or Rathbone. I think it was Rathbone.
Every time you've gone back there, you never saw John Wilkes Booth kill Lincoln?
No, and I was sent 8 times, and I saw the Lincolns coming into Ford's Theater, and I once got behind their seating and saw President Lincoln sitting there, and he looked like a suit of bones. He was incredibly emaciated, just as he was when he walked in to Ford's Theater, kind of hobbling in a hobbled kind of way, kind of almost crunched over. He was very emaciated by 1865. But I've said in many radio interviews, even with George Norrie on Coast to Coast, or when I was interviewed for William Shatner's Weird or What on, the History Channel, that every time, or 6 of the times they sent me to Ford's Theater, that the Lincolns weren't there. And then a researcher named John Boda in this country found that there was an understandable reason for that, and that was the Lincolns came to Ford's Theater like 15 to 30 minutes late. So when DARPA's Project Pegasus was sending me there in 1971, 106 years after Lincoln's shooting at Ford's Theater, they were sending me to 8 o'clock on April 15th of 1865, Ford's Theater, Washington, D.C., but that was too early.
And
that's why I never saw the Lincoln.
And you only have and you only have 15 minutes.
Right, before a density effect occurred. And there were a number of times it did, and the portal was out in the dirt outside. But just to kind of go back a tick, when they sent me there on the dirt in front of Ford's Theater, I would just walk in to, it wasn't a booth, it was a table that was set up in the doorway. And one time it would be a man. The next time they sent me would be that man and his son. The third time it would be his son. The fourth time it would be his son and his son's best friend. Then it would be his son's best friend and that individual's sister and so forth. It was always a different person. Then I would work farther into the lobby after I explained that my dad was working for the Lincoln administration. And I was dressed like in a little Lord Fauntleroy kind of finery. I was quite embarrassed to be wearing that. But they wanted me to look like the son of a Lincoln administration official, which I had to say to get in to Ford's Theater and up to the balcony seating without having a ticket. They apparently didn't have a fine enough reproduction of the tickets of that night. You know, Our American Cousin starring Laura Keene. And I would always get in, but then it would be like a man would walk by talking to a dandy talking to two lovely damsels who looked like twin sisters. And then another time I was sent, it was just one woman. And that one time I was looking to my right and I saw myself moving along right along with me, and I thought it was a hallway mirror. And then that image of me walked off the wall, and I thought, my God, that's me during a future trip. Then when I did that future trip, about on my sixth probe via Chronovisor from the Sirius Cultural Center in 1971, I looked over to my left, and there I was on my left. We have been told, however, that if we ever went to, like, New Mexico after we had teleported home or touched ourselves from a previous chronovised image, they wanted to avoid that because they thought there might be, what, the curve of binding energy, as John McPhee put it, and there would be a massive explosion. So that was dangerous when they were sending me to Ford's Theater. But I survived, and I was really more proud of the fact that I advised General George Washington to retreat his troops from New York Harbor, because I want all of my fellow Americans to know that the person who ran for president in 2016 and got about 25,000 votes was the American who was sent back in time to advise General George Washington to retreat his troops from New York Harbor. That was my mission, and that allowed the Revolutionary Army to be saved. And also that as a result of being in the Josephine Cobb image of Lincoln at Gettysburg, when they sent me to, what was it, November 19th, 1863, and I ended up in that famous image, which was until like 2007, the only photograph showing Lincoln at Gettysburg on the day he gave the speech there. As a result, I was the only living American featured in Canon Rick Burns' The Civil War. Now, did that qualify to me to be elected president? No, I think I had other qualifying characteristics as an individual. But I just want Americans to know they are not being told the truth, even about what our great, uniquely American civilization has accomplished. I am one of those Americans. I met with General George Washington. That is not an urban legend, a conspiracy theory, or some science fiction fantasy. That is American history. That is what I got my BA in at UCLA, studying with Robert Dallek and the rest of those brilliant historians at UCLA during those years. I'm just sharing this so that Americans know that somebody who was telling the truth about not only our time travel accomplishments, but the fact that as a result, the 1970s got interpolated in 1776 needs to be known. It's something that our great nation accomplished.
Okay.
And I was there. I participated.
That's what okay. So I was going to ask you, because, and I see that some of this has been percolating in the chat room as well, and it's a wonderful question, and I want to get around to this right after I ask this next question. The first one was about Mandela effect, because what you're describing as far as multiverse goes seems like it could be a really great way of encapsulating what everybody's theorizing about Mandela. But here's my question about 1776 and Washington's miraculous escape from Brooklyn.
He was in Brooklyn Heights, but the his army was down at New York Harbor, right?
Right. Well, my question is this:
West Virginia sharpshooters were killed. Yeah.
You just said that if it weren't for your trip through time, your mission to warn Washington and save the revolution at that point, that would insinuate that the army prior to your trip in 1960 had failed, but you are...
No. That's the mystery of retrocausation. No, I was always there. In fact, they found chronovisor images of me briefing Washington, and that's why they sent me. They literally had me memorize the demarche that I gave General Washington. So that's the mystery of the paradox of time travel. When you go back in time, you can't change the past because you're there. So they sent me back because I always was in the event, and they thought, well, we don't want to push this time space, this area of time space, to another time place in time space where Washington doesn't retreat his troops. But in this dimension, where that was always history before I went there, or when I was, for example, always in the Josephine Com image before going to Gettysburg on November 19th, 1863. So the paradox of retrocausation is you can't go back to the past in this dimension to change the past because you're in the past. You can only go back to fulfill it, and that's what I did. So before I went to visit General Washington, I had already done so. I didn't know it because DARPA hadn't told me, but they said, Andy, you've got a very important assignment. We have filmed you briefing General George Washington at Brooklyn Heights to retreat his troops, from New York Harbor and escape to Manhattan, which they did. And in fact, I was down in the swale, as were some of the other kids that went with me, when all of the troops were coming up the swale saying, are you boys angels? We've heard that before he left for Manhattan, General Washington said you were angels. In fact, this is part of American history that I want known. You know that famous Curry and Ive drawing of Washington in his tent at Brooklyn Heights, and there's a little boy outside his tent? That is me, based on Washington telling that story for the rest of his life, that during the Revolution he was visited by angels. He was not. He was visited by U.S. child chrononauts from the 1970s, and I was one of them. How can I spend 4 years studying American history, in fact, especially presidential history, at UCLA and not reveal this to my fellow citizens? It was imperative that I do so, because I knew that this is what had shaped 1776 and the success of Washington in this dimension. But they knew if they decided to not send me after finding me via chronovision at that time, place, and time space, then our time place might shift to an America that didn't exist. We might all find ourselves speaking perfectly unaccented British English rather than American English, or even German, which lost at the Constitutional Convention by one vote to English as our national language. So they knew these kinds of trade-offs, and they knew that they could send me there to fulfill what they wanted to fulfill, but not to change it. So whenever I get a call from somebody asking me to tell them how to go back in time and overcome a disease or save a deceased loved one from an accident or an illness or whatever, I can't do so, and they can't do so, because you can't go back into the past or future and change things because that's where you are. How can you change a reality that you're in when you time travel to it? It's that event.
It's a great question, and it blows my mind. Actually, breaks when I try to conceive of it. And I've been looking as you're saying this. I have the Gettysburg photo, but I'm looking for the Currier and Ives photo. I wish I had known this prior to our call.
It's not a photo. It's a drawing.
The drawing. Yeah.
Illustration. Yeah.
Right. I'm looking for that, and I wish I had a little bit of more foresight. I could have found that.
Just put in. Drawing General Washington, Courier and Ives.
I did.
Two R's in Courier. Now, Ives is, I believe, I-V-E-S.
I-V-E-S,
that
yeah.
came out like in the 1930s or the 1830s or something. But it was based on Washington always telling the story how during the Revolution he was visited by these young angels. He was saying, Andrew, that's your name, right? Didn't you tell me that your name was Andrew? He sounded like King Charles III. He sounded British because he was a British gentleman fighting for the rights of a British gentleman. Even Ben Franklin was identified as B. Franklin Esquire on statues of him, which was originally not a lawyer, but halfway between a lord and a gentleman. Okay, so Washington had kind of a British accent. And he said, well, Andrew, that's your name, right? old chap. Yeah. Well, Andrew, you're saying that you're time travelers from the 1970s? Well, listen, I know about travel. If I, for example, travel between New York City and Philadelphia, I can walk or perhaps ride a stallion or take a carriage. But what do you mean by time travel? I don't understand this phrase you're using. And tell me, son, are you angels? You must be angels. So what I'm saying, Frank, is that General George Washington quizzed me about whether we were angels. He thought we were angels. He talked about it for the rest of his life. And yet it went down in the Courier Knives drawing as a little boy outside his tent. And that was actually more accurate than the story that Washington had been telling all those years until the end of his life.
Well, but
it was us.
But here's the thing. You don't have, as a child especially, you don't have any autonomy on where you're going and what your mission is. So did DARPA was telling you to go and meet and warn, give military advice to George Washington?
They not only told me that I was, they had me learn and memorize what they had recorded me saying when they used Chronovision to see me going there. Because the past, present, and future exist all the time. It's all there. It's just your perspective. And they had found a way to send us there to another time, place, and time space. So they recorded what I said to Washington. See, they were studying chronovised images from the past initially with books, letters, diaries, postcards, records, documents. And they were comparing the memorialized general and then President George Washington to what they were getting via Chronovision. And they slapped their foreheads and said, oh my God, Ray's son Andrew is doing the demarche to General Washington. So they came to me at Mount View Road School in Morris Plains, New Jersey, a woman from DARPA. She only came once. She wasn't one of my regular instructors in the program. And she sat me down in this little tiny room at my elementary school and said, Andrew, I'm going to share something with you very sensitive. You cannot tell anybody. When we used the chronovisor on General George Washington in August of 1776, we found the interior of his tent at Brooklyn Heights right before he ordered his troops to retreat from New York Harbor en route to Manhattan, the island of Manhattan. And Andrew, we want you to know that it was you. So don't worry. You do a great job on the demarche, but you're going to have to learn that demarche and then go there and brief General George Washington. So let's show you a picture of what General Washington looks like again. So when you go there, you're just going to realize he's just a great man who helped found our country. And so I have it in my book. I kind of spent a lot of memory work, remembering after 50 years what I told him when I was sent to 1776 in 1970, from my time. I said something like, General George Washington, we are time travelers from your own future. We have been sent here by the government of our nation, the United States of America, to tell you that you are destined to win the war upon which you are currently engaged. The winning of this war will lead to the founding of the greatest nation in the history of Earth, that you will be the first president of that country. It will be called the United States of America. And as a result of your victory in this war as its leader and being the first president of the United States of America after the Articles of Confederation, 1789 forward, you will be known for all time in the history of this great country as the father of your country. But Sir General Washington, we have been sent here to tell you that none of these propitious events — I had to learn the word propitious because that's what they had heard me and recorded me saying to Washington — none of these propitious or propitious events will happen unless you retreat your troops immediately from New York Harbor. And he said, well, Andrew, I'm shocked. How do I know that you're from another time? And what do you mean about time travel? So then we went into all that I just previously told you. So he was mystified. And then after further discussion, when I showed him a two-dimensional sort of hologram from what like was coming out in National Geographic at that time, it was an American bald eagle kind of landing on a red, white, and blue crest. And I said, well, General Washington, I knew that you might not believe us. So I was given this artifact, this printed artifact, to show you and so that you would believe what we're telling you. And I handed that hologram to General Washington. And as instructed, said, if you look at that, sir, surely, General Washington, that is not from your time and place. And he said, well, I must agree, Andrew. Surely I'm going to have to show old Ben Franklin this. I imagine he's going to be fascinated. Because it was a printing artifact from the 1970s. So Washington got that. He thought a little. He sort of put his fingers up to his mouth. And by the way, he had granny glasses, just like Franklin. That really surprised me. But he had a very hammy sort of German face. I wouldn't even be surprised if Washington was von Wessington or something.
Well, you know,
a very hammy face.
Yeah, Andrew, I'm sorry to interrupt with this because this is a very compelling part of your, you know, your total story here. But I would have to imagine that this, for at least people, a lot of people in this audience, this right here would be one of the harder pills to swallow for some, only because I think it would be very hard for anybody who is, you know, looks into the culture, the nature of government as it is today, and would ever think that even 40, 50 years ago or so, there would be any kind of group on the inside, especially in DARPA, that would be benevolent enough and love America and want to see it succeed enough that it would go on an endeavor to help fortify it. As we can see, there's all guns are pointed inward on us to try to hasten our destruction at this point. This is even hard for me to conceive of, just because it's such a benevolent mission. And they had all, look.
The Americans I served with in DARPA's Project Pegasus were loyal, patriotic, great Americans, including my late father. Most of them had served in World War II. My father as a combat medic and ambulance driver in France and Germany during the war. He had had paratrooper training at Camp Lejeune in North Carolina. He was there in France and Germany being delivered by a glider to set the arms and legs that had been broken during our parachute missions into France and Germany. And they were not members of the deep state trying to subvert the American Revolution. They wanted it continued. And that's what I've been trying to do by telling the truth to the American people about the fact that we have Tesla teleportation that can completely replace planes, trains, and automobiles. You know, Frank, we lose as many Americans every year from automobiles, 50,000. Has died during all 13 years of the Vietnam War. But our colleges aren't up in protest about what Ralph Nader called unsafe at any speed, the modern automobile. We also have as many casualties, 300,000 a year. I'm trying to bring about teleportation to achieve a better, safer world and America. But in this area, I'm trying to correct the history that was given to us with true history, so we can get back on course and remember the America that was supposed to be, one in which the deep state didn't exist, one in which the Fourth Reich was not a faction that our government got into an unholy alliance with to even, you know, safeguard Hitler so he could get to Argentina on way to Paraguay and live until 1962, just because so we could get German rocket experts to fight the Soviet Russians. I'm engaged in a corrective function in American history. So we have to avoid the presentist violation in historiography, saying that now because we're worried about abuses of power by the U.S. intelligence community and U.S. military, and corporations, that therefore it's hard to believe that these people like Harold Agnew and Sterling Colgate and my late father were villains. They weren't. I wasn't. He wasn't. We were trying to prevent America from going into the dustbin, as one of the CIA people on the project, Courtney M. Hunt, once said to me. We were trying to protect the country. So when they sent me to visit Washington, and I showed him that hologram, he then resolutely stood up, and with the sort of magisterial, resolute brilliance of General George Washington, later President Washington, he said, "I shall order the retreat immediately." So I witnessed the actual basis by which, let's say, a David McCulloch can write 1776, circa, what, 2005, I think, David put out that book, and they're still saying, we don't know why General George Washington retreated his troops from New York Harbor. I do. I told him to. Now, you can choose not to believe that. You can choose to pull what I call a cliff high and say, well, Andy must be delusional because time travel doesn't exist. And my response to Mr. High is, how do you know that? My father and I were working with the Manhattan Project physicists like Edward Teller and Harold Agnew. Who would develop time travel besides somebody like my father, who studied engineering at Lehigh, at the world's leading electrical engineering program, and then repeated Tesla's teleportation experiments at the Edison Labs? Who would be on such a project? So what I'm saying is that explanations that violate historiography and true history are even being done by our leading physicists, Michio Kaku, Ronald Mallet, the late Stephen Hawking, David Deutsch of Oxford. They are stating that they don't, that they weren't led into these black projects, and then they're saying they know that time travel hasn't been developed. I'm here to say what really disturbed Dr. Mallet. It's been done. It was done by DARPA. I was in it. I spoke to my father, Courtney Hunt of the CIA, Dr. Agnew, Dr. Colgate, a engineer admitted into professional engineering status in New Jersey and California, like my late father was, named Captain Lewis B. Wary, W-A-R-Y. He saw the Tesla teleporter at Curtis Wright when he was working, directing 1,500 Americans on a cooling system on one of our most advanced nuclear submarines. And he said, "What's that?" And then he went by that room again. It had disappeared. In other words, I had a professional engineer in New Jersey who saw the Tesla teleporter and didn't know what it was. I had witnesses, okay? We analyzed the Josephine Cobb image at me at Gettysburg, and just like I had said, I was disappearing from view when the picture was taken and going back to East Hanover, New Jersey, to again meet my late father and Sterling Colgate at that totally windowless brick building in East Hanover where the plasma confinement chamber was located. Brett Stillings, my fellow Mars astronaut, and John Gannon analyzed that picture, and they found that in the picture, at the tightest tuning in of the photograph, you can see that my eye socket and my cheekbones are disappearing from view.
Yeah,
so in other words,
it looks like a blank face. We're looking at it right now. It looks like a blank face.
Well, when you tuned it up, there was distortion of the cheekbone and the eye socket. Now, by the way, when I looked at that picture when it was published in a U.S. news magazine in like 1972, right before I moved to California from New Jersey, I showed that to one of those pictures to one of my sisters. And I said, "Sis, that's me in Gettysburg." And she said, "No, it isn't. It's just some boy that looks like you in Gettysburg." I then showed it to my father as he was reading the Sunday New York Times on his easy chair inside the living room. And he said, "Yep, just don't tell anybody." When that picture was originally published, before it became the only classified photograph at the National Archives, the only classified historical photograph in the U.S. Archives, the National Archives, you could see that that was me. But now what I said I was wearing can be seen. The fact that I had been in a Union bugle boy outfit that John Lawrence Burns had outfitted me with, these kind of long shoes that are going under my pants. and so forth. I had like a hodgepodge of clothes. I even went to the millinery shop in Gettysburg that David Kendallhart and Eliza Ann Bowen owned. John Lawrence Burns, as he was fitting me with the clothes, was kind of confronted by Mrs. Kendallhart, Eliza Ann Bowen. And David Kendallhart was identified in the town almanac of that time as attorney, town council president, and shoemaker. And John Lawrence Burns was identified as constable and cobbler. Gettysburg was a small southern Pennsylvania market town and crossroads. All of those streets, Baltimore, Washington, Emmitsburg, pointed to distant towns or cities in America. And I knew I was going to walk down Baltimore. No, not Baltimore. This was Washington. I was going to walk down Washington and make a left at Upper Emmitsburg Pike, now known as Ehrenberg Road, and go into that millinery shop. When the shops in Gettysburg only had like a wooden sidewalk with like three or four shops, I went back to Gettysburg in 2013, the first American to return to an American city 150 years after he first went there. That is fact. That is true history. So anyway, I was prepared, dressed in a Union Bugle Boy outfit, but not given a bugle. And when I asked Valerie, the woman who dressed me, why not? She said, Andy, I see in your records here you play alto saxophone, not trumpet. I don't want you to take a bugle and not be able to play it. Because if you were a Union Bugle Boy, you'd know how to play all kinds of songs, like taps or whatever.
Yeah, you don't want to be put on the spot, huh?
Right.
Right.
So, but again, there were times when the butterfly effect occurred, like that time I went back to our house and it was a different family. And when that little girl didn't return from Sandia, when we got transplanted, you know, the quantum excursion to 1991 from 1971. So I knew that I might not get back from Gettysburg. I knew I might not get back from briefing Washington.
Well,
but I knew I would participate in history, and I was proud to do it. So, well, I'm telling the truth.
Oh, I'm following along here, and I'm seriously, this has been a one hell of a ride, and my thing right now is, we definitely have to do more on this. I want to get into even more detail, but we are up against the clock soon, so I want to ask a modern question about, because you had said something a few minutes ago about corrective functions and being able to go and do some corrective work. And that was with Washington. I wanted to ask you something modern before we at least have to do something about the jump rooms and Project Mars before we wrap up here. So the first thing I want to ask you is actually a theory that is, you know, it is rooted in some historical fact, at least that we've been able to confirm. And it's very popular among at least people in this audience and audiences like it. And that is this question about whether or not Donald Trump had any kind of connection to the Tesla technology because of his uncle John Trump being part of the reclamation crew that went and grabbed all of Tesla's stuff after his death in that hotel that he was living at, and whether or not he had any. You know, there's just a lot of time travel theories about the Trumps, the time-traveling Trumps, and whether or not they were beneficiaries of this technology. Real quick about that, because I want to get to the jump rooms. You have any insight on that?
I have no direct evidence that President Trump had prior knowledge. I was at a banquet in Albuquerque in 1971 when both Bushes were there, and they knew. In fact, George W. got right in front of my face and said, "Have you heard, Andy? My daddy and I are going to be president." And, you know, his father would say, "Not W, don't go there. Come on, just, you know, hold it. No, don't go there." And then I was at a smaller luncheon with Bill Clinton on my left, Harold Agnew, Ivan Browning when he was director of science and technology for CIA, and my father and Joe Connison from the Ralph M. Parsons Company. They were both on the project. And I was sitting right next to a very young Bill Clinton. I mean, I would think he might have even been like at Georgetown. And they said, how are you doing with the information, Bill? And he said in his native Arkansas twang, well, you know, fellas, I know you're all members of the atomic research community, and I know you're always doing amazing things by building more destructive nuclear bombs, nuclear weapons. But some mornings I have to get up and look in the mirror and I have to pinch myself and say, me, Bill Clinton, President of the United States, well, fellas, that dog don't hunt, okay? So I know that those three had prior knowledge of their presidencies. I also know that Barry Satoru, who later took the name of a fellow student of Stanley Ann Dunham, his putative mother, who I don't believe was his mother, I believe she was his handler for the CIA, who took the name Barack Obama, he and I were told in 1980, when not DARPA, but the DOD was training us for Mars service, that we were both future presidents, he in his late 40s and me in my late 60s. I'm sharing that not because I'm going to be running for president again. I may run for the Senate, but maybe it'll happen. I don't know. But I'm not going to run for the presidency. Maybe I end up president. I don't know. But now, regarding President Trump, I do know that when he was not even, well, when he was about 40, around 1986, he was on the Phil Donahue show, and my late father, who was not CIA, but he had reporting requirements to all U.S. intel agencies and military departments, shushed me while Mr. Trump was being interviewed by Phil Donahue and said, quiet, Andy, I want to listen to this guy. He's one of our future presidents. So I know the CIA knew about the Trump presidency. Now, it is true that John Trump, his uncle, was on the one of the teams that recovered Tesla's paperwork, either FBI or War Department, which later, of course, became the Department of Defense. We also know that the books of Ingersoll Lockwood from around 1900, one of which I think is called Baron Trump, one of which is called, like, The Last President, published around 1900, mentions the Trump name, Trump's vice president, whose name is escaping me for some reason.
Pence,
Mike Pence. Pence is listed not as like vice president, but as like the interior secretary. And so the novels of Ingersoll Lockwood may have been just one of those amazing psychic impressions of a Trump presidency, or may have been planted in the past by Project Pegasus. I don't know. I do know that when I wrote President Trump on July 28th of 2020 about declassifying the American presence on Mars, going back to 1964, a few weeks later, Eric Trump and President Donald Trump said at the Wednesday and Thursday night of the RNC that we have to finally go to Mars. And there I was as a former writer for Jacques Cousteau for 3 years, a protege of editor Norman Cousins, somebody who published multiple environmental policy papers at the international peer-reviewed level, who was admitted to the federal and state bar in Washington State, who had worked in two classified defense projects for the U.S. government, even when he was a child and a young adult, when Mr. Trump was still a kind of a plutocrat playboy, that I was telling him about our presence on Mars, and he had his son, and he himself, I think, responded, because supposedly he reads everything, suggesting that we finally have to go to Mars. In the case of the letter that I wrote to former President Obama, he had previously made fun of his fellow Mars astronauts. And when I wrote him again on July 28th of 2020, when I sent the letter to President Trump, he changed his position and admitted there was a secret space program, but he just couldn't talk about it. So there's been some movement. You know, we had movement by the Israeli general Haim Ashed acknowledging on December 9th of 2020.
I remember that.
The American presence on the Red Planet. So we're getting some movement.
When you say American, or we need to go to Mars, Now, like I said, it's 11:45 over here on the East Coast, and we have to wrap up sometime around midnight. But I always knew if we were going to do this the right way, I'd love to have you back as part of maybe like
a
series.
I'd love to come back, Frank.
That'd be great. But to be able to do this right and not jump and not to rush through anything. As far as these jump rooms, Project Mars, you said this was as when we were talking about chronovising and time travel with Pegasus, this you described as the advent of interdimensional. Now, when we coming up through American education as little children, we learn about the solar system and the physical location of where Mars and Saturn and Jupiter is all that is. We're thinking physical. We're thinking this frequency of light. We're not thinking about another dimension. So how does interdimensional what is interdimensional about your going to Mars, and why is going to Mars so important?
Good questions. Time travel is dimensional travel. If we went to New Mexico in fall of 1971 and arrived at the beginning of the summer of 1973, which we did, and my father's friend Connie Chavez just fell off her chair at the La Hacienda restaurant in Old Town Albuquerque, when I went over to where they were located in the restaurant and answered my dad's question, which what year it was. And I said, what year it is? It's 1971, isn't it? But it was the beginning of the summer of 71. That was time travel. That's what I mean about dimensional travel. Now, what I mean about the advance that was made within 10 years when Project Mars was launched is we weren't necessarily going to the Mars in the sky in the past, present, or future. We were going to what they thought was Mars, but wait a minute. They weren't traveling there with like Tesla teleportation. They were using the aeronautical repositioning chamber. We would go into an elevator. It would morph from a box into a cylinder, and then initially about 20 minutes and then 8 minutes or so as the what we called Mars was drawing closer to our planet, it would open up in the sub-basement of a U.S. facility. There are about eight in the middle latitudes of Mars, okay? The very nicer areas of Mars, not the really hot, not the really frozen. Now, what I think was going on in what we call Project Mars was interdimensional travel as it was then appearing in science fiction novels, like the science fiction fantasy mixed with a little soft porn, I guess, for young men, known as the Blade series by Richard Lord. I don't know if he was American or British, but it was a famous series from the 70s. It was essentially what Blade was doing. We were entering a box and traveling interdimensionally. In other words, it wasn't this planet or the history or future of this planet in the past, present, or future, which was either just travel, you know, real-time transit via teleportation was just travel. It was just very fast travel. But with adjustments for the past and future, we still got to places on Earth that either once existed or will exist on Earth. But in the aeronautical repositioning chamber, we were going to another place. I think it was interdimensional, so much so that I don't think they knew it if it was the real Mars that's in our night sky. That would explain why Major Ed Baines would always debrief us for about 45 minutes each time we came home. Okay, Andy, what happened next? Then what happened? Then what did you see? Then what did you do? Then what did the predators do? In other words, they were taking copious notes on everything we had experienced in that realm. I think they knew or suspected that it wasn't Mars in real time. Maybe Elon Musk has been briefed on that fact, and that's why he's still insisting on sending people to Mars for the first time. But I'm so certain that it was interdimensional travel rather than space travel, that rather than identifying myself as a US chrononaut involved in Project Pegasus during the advent of time travel and a US astronaut involved in Project Mars during the advent of interplanetary exploration, which connotes space, not time space, I'm now simply saying end as a end in the Project Mars during the advent of interdimensional travel. And I'm just identifying myself again as a U.S. chrononaut. because I believe that we remained U.S. chrononauts, not astronauts, when we were going to quote-unquote Mars. And that explains why Bernie Mendez suggested several alternate theories for what was really happening. He was actually on the program to answer those types of questions. That it wasn't Mars in the night sky, it was like a Mars-like planet, and they thought originally it was Mars. You know, for example, Penny Bradley has claimed that there was a German presence on the Mars, as did Clark McClellan of NASA, who even claimed there was kind of like a Fourth Reich ethos at NASA, where they were doing high Hitler salutes to each other, and not just Wernher von Braun, all of them. But there couldn't have been, it couldn't have been the same place, because I went up there to quote-unquote Mars 20 times or so between 1981 and 1984, and there was no German presence. We weren't trained in German presence. We met no Germans. We saw no German insignia, no swastikas, no Prussian eagles. We heard no German accents. There was no German presence on Mars. I began calling that school of the secret space program Germania because I didn't believe it. I'm now leaning towards the probability that we were going to another location in time-space, but it was not the planetary usufruct known as planet Mars.
That's
somewhere else.
That's interesting. That's very interesting. And I got to say, I already have so many questions for the next. And you know, my cousin Sherry's here, too. We both are probably...
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Sheri says hello. We're bubbling with questions, and we're gonna have to compile them for the next time. I'm thinking about we were talking about Mandela effect before, but now you got me thinking about, first of all, I mean, this all started. You were talking to us tonight. This all started about a response. There needing to be a response to extraterrestrial craft over the skies of D.C. in 1952. So we need to be able to talk about that a little bit more at another time. What about all of these missions, all of these projects were important for meeting the presence?
Well, Frank, real quickly.
Yeah.
Why were the ETs coming? All the nuclear bombs were blowing up.
Okay.
What could have led to the Mandela effect? The same. Do we have evidence of the Mandela effect even in Ken and Rick Burns' The Civil War? Yes. What does he have Sam Waterston say? That they have thus far so nobly carried on. I memorized the Gettysburg Address as a school student, and it was that they have thus far so nobly advanced. So I believe the Mandela effect is real, but it hasn't been caused by time travel. None of these devices did anything more than sort of local effects in time space. Sure, the Mars one was very advanced, but you know, I don't think they were so disruptive as different exopolitical figures like Kerry Cassidy was claiming. No, I don't think it was from these devices like teleporters or chronovisors. I think the Mandela effect has been happening, and it's the net effect of over 2,000 nuclear explosions on Earth, the very reason that was causing the ETs to begin visiting us in earnest after August 6th of 1945.
There's more too. When you come back, we have to talk about CERN. We have to talk about Antarctica. But here's the last thing I would like to get out of you before we close the books on this, and then me and Sheri we'll sit behind and just, you know, share our own thoughts with each other and wrap this episode up. Why, my question to you, why are these jump rooms and these chronovisors in places like museums and community centers instead, because if it's technological in nature, why aren't they put into really well-kept facilities? Why so public? Are they taking advantage of ley lines of energy? Is it a highway of portals that we can't see? What is this?
There was no connection between these different devices and ley lines.
Okay.
Ley lines are real, but that wasn't, it was just the devices that did these things. They can put them wherever they wanted. Now, that's basically my response to that. But there's something else you mentioned in regard. Oh, museums. I've been calling for public-private committees to decant certain scenes via chronovision to the public. Like children could see the Gettysburg Address just as I was sent there. Or they could see George Washington laying the cornerstone of our nation's capital on September 18th of 1793. That's what I've been calling for 20 years. that's one of the things I said I would deliver as president if I had been elected in 2016. If I am elected president or become president, that's what I will try to deliver. Now, the reason you want a controlled release of chronovision is privacy is a very important human virtue. And I'm sure we would agree that we wouldn't want any of our personal sex lives to become the pornography of the future any more than we would want to see President Lincoln relieving himself in the loo or making love to Mrs. Lincoln. We would want to see the Gettysburg Address or even maybe him meeting with his generals during the war, but we would want to see personal experiences. So I don't support a general release of chronovision, but a controlled release through kind of a public-private committee of distinguished Americans. Similarly, I don't want to have mass time travel, because mass time travel by mass people on mass timelines would lead to mass chaos, especially economically and socially. Imagine all of the money in America that would flood into Apple computers and Microsoft the day before their initial public offering, if people knew what they were going to become. So we can't have mass time travel. I've called for Tesla teleportation in real time, but also the limited use of some time travel, like let's say 3 lifetimes or 3 yearly exposures to the Montauk chair, used, let's say, under the guidance of a psychotherapist to, let's say, show somebody who has lost a child that 5 years later they're having another child and bouncing that beautiful infant on their knee. So I believe that things like the Montauk chair should be semi-disclosed, and Tesla teleportation in real time should be introduced. But time travel? No, it would give those time traveling inordinate opportunities to screw everything up. The non-linear reality would become unmanageable, and they knew that. The people like my dad on Project Pegasus could only buy or invest in Texas and Oklahoma oil and natural gas stock when they were on Project Pegasus. That was it. They could not do any other investments on the stock market, because they didn't want individuals privateering on what they knew of the future. So I want these historical scenes to be shown. I love American history. I love, for example, the works of Ken Burns. Every one of them, I've seen every one of them. But I despair, as somebody educated in history at UCLA and who went to some historical experiences for the US government, that we still are not revealing true history to the American people. We're behind the times. I mean, I was told when I went to 2045 via Stargate, and I was shown that you could get into a teleporter like device in an elevator like device in one building, and come out in another building in another city. I did that. Are we going to get there by 2045? Not as long as everybody says, well, Andy's just telling a science fiction story. I'm not. I'm an experiencer of real historical research and development by the greatest nation on earth, and I even ran for president to publicize this and to get this done, and people are still doubting it. I don't know what else I can do. I can't, stand on my head and spit nickels or snap my fingers and say, well, this is what happened. The government's going to have to tell you. And the whole evolution of the deep state has complicated this. I mean, I just found out from somebody that, the Nazi salute was being used at NASA under Wernher von Braun, not as a joke, but as a practice, showing fealty to the Nazis and all the rocket scientists who would come over. That's serious. It looks like we were complicit in getting Hitler to Argentina en route to Paraguay. It does.
There's a lot of questions.
Lot to begin asking about history, and all I've been trying to do is tell the true history of what I know. The existence of what Weber has called the chronarchy. There has been at least the briefing of future presidents and vice presidents. In addition, I had a lunch with a 29-year-old Richard Bruce Cheney. He knew he was going to be vice president. And look at the role he played on 9/11. He was the U.S. president on 9/11. He ordered the hit, you know, the strike on Flight 93. This matters. The use of time travel to brief these people caused a 19-20-year-old Barry Satoru to know he was going to be a president named Barack Obama. That's probably why he took the name of his putative mother, Stanley Ann Dunham's classmate from the University of Hawaii, in 1983. When I met him in West L.A., he was suddenly calling himself Barack Obama, and I knew him as Barry Satoru, as did other people around L.A. So this is part of our history, and I'm simply trying to advance true history. It matters.
Well, there is... we're going to have plenty of opportunities to do a little bit more of that here because, truly, we're probably a couple of episodes away from maybe getting what I would say the first couple of volumes of Andrew Basiago on, quite frankly, because we have a lot. I've been taking notes here and squirreling them away, and I know that there's going to be more follow-ups as the days go on. And but in the meantime, Andrew, I just want to thank you for your time here tonight. We almost did a full 2 hours together. You have a blog, a website, a radio show, anything you'd like to plug?
Well, you know, I've lost a lot of vision from my project experiences and possibly a DEW attacks on me when I ran for president and then shortly thereafter. I can see, but I'm challenged visually. I may be able to get devices to improve it, so I'm hopeful. Certainly as a lawyer and writer, that matters, and a voracious reader. I was running a couple of websites, but projectpegasus.com got stolen, and then projectpegasus.net got stolen. So I have some papers at projectpegasus.info, which my great friend Michael Petrovich here in Washington State put up for me recently. I had a projectmars.net that's still up there. When Facebook really took off, I started Project Pegasus, my time travel group on Facebook, and Project Mars, my Mars group on Facebook. And that's grown to like 13,500 Mars anomalous. And I think the leading Mars anomaly group in the world. And then I could sit back and enjoy National Geographic and Ron Howard stealing my 2008 paper, The Discovery of Life on Mars, and even putting capital M-A-R-S on their special edition of National Geographic on Mr. Howard's special documentary about Mars. So I'm even had my stuff stolen by luminaries here in America. I hope I've become one myself. But they're still up there. I'm not reading them. I'm sometimes narrating written things to them. Like I'm going to be putting some quotable quotes up on those, that and my political site, Andy for America. I'll probably be announcing soon that that's going to be my Senate campaign site.
Well, that'd be wonderful.
Those are good ones to visit. There's always interesting things put up there. Like on Project Pegasus on Facebook, we had like a 76 or 79-year-old British gentleman say that in the very years that I was in Project Pegasus, sort of 1968 to 72, 73, he was doing time travel technical work at Oxford. And as a CANTEP, as a graduate of the University of Cambridge, I was very interested in what that man had to say. I can't see an elderly Briton claiming that he went to Oxford and was working on time travel there. I'd love to know why David Deutsch of Oxford never knew that, just like Stephen Hawking of my alma mater, Cambridge, never knew that. Just like Michio Kaku and Ronald Mallett have denied that in this country. So I think that one of the things we can contextualize with these alternative media digital platforms in the digital age is that many of our leading scientists are simply apparatchiks working for the deep state to conceal things that have been developed and discovered.
For example,
when I approached Dr. Kaku in 1982, at the Committee to Bridge the Gap, Dan Hirsch's organization in West L.A., I began telling him about my time travel experiences, and Dr. Kaku walked right around after telling me that he didn't have access to such secrets because he wouldn't work on more destructive nuclear weapons with Edward Teller, one of the physicists on Pegasus. And when I told him I had teleported for Dr. Agnew and Dr. Teller, he actually turned around and walked across the auditorium to avoid discussing time travel with me. And then what did Dr. Kaku go on to do? Write books about when time travel will be discovered, if at all.
You know, I got to say,
information that's being spread.
Yeah, especially when it comes to Michio Kaku, we've all rolled our eyes collectively when we've seen him make. I think it was just a couple of years ago, maybe three years ago at most. He was on MSNBC with maybe three or four. It was with Charlie Rose before he got kicked off for one scandal or another. And he was there talking about how cloud seeding through laser technology was something that was just being kicked around right now, whether or not they'd be able to seed clouds and be able to manipulate weather, that it will be possible one day through the power of lasers, but we're so far off. Whereas we know anybody who has been even mildly interested in the subject knows that weather manipulation has been militarized in the same decade that you were doing all this this jumping around. And I got to say,
and time travel was militarized, right?
Right.
It was always in the W division of LANL. Agnew was the quintessential Manhattan Project physicist. So that's the disaster that I'm trying to correct. I want to see Tesla teleportation in real time, so that let's say, you know, a pregnant woman in London isn't going to be on a commercial airliner and all that radiation up in the sky going to Sydney, Australia, but getting there in several seconds. That's got to be better than 24 hours on a commercial airliner.
Absolutely.
She doesn't want to have a miscarriage or some defect in her child.
I would rather not fly again.
Fighting for humanity's right to teleport. Even if we lose some people, even in time-space teleporting, we certainly won't lose 50,000 Americans a year and have 300,000 catastrophic automobile accidents. So that's what I've been fighting for, and we're not going to get that as long as we continue naively believing that the conventional scientists of our culture are not government disinformants.
Yeah.
They are deep state operatives who are disinforming us. I witnessed it right in how Dr. Kaku treated me when I started telling him about my Tesla teleportation experiments in 10 years earlier. I thought I left 10 years early, 1972, when I met him in 1982. And what did he do? He turned around and quickly walked away from, and then wrote books about the possible advent someday of time travel.
Well, it's very well said, and I know that you are pretty limited with what you have available on the net, but now that we've been linked together, and again, very big thanks to Aaron Moriarty of Truth Quest radio show. I'd love anything that you have for as an update. We'll keep in touch, and I'll pass the word along, and I can't wait to have you back. Andrew Basiago, thank you for everything tonight, and it's been, at the very least, a very entertaining, mind-blowing way to spend a Saturday evening, so thank you so much.
Thank you.
You got it, Frank.
All right. Well,
Sheri.
Thanks.
Have yourself a wonderful weekend. We'll be in touch, and thank you for all of your time.
You as well. Thank you so much.
All right. Be well. There you go, ladies and gentlemen. That is Andrew Basiago. I learned his name correctly before. Now, Sheri, you sent me this wonderful picture.
Which what? The one of Washington?
Yes.
Well, that has him and angels, but they're all little girls.
No,
so.
but the boy is outside the door.
Oh, I didn't see that.
Hold on, look, I got to show you.
Wait a minute.
I'm gonna send it to myself. I'm gonna put it up on screen. There is a little boy outside the door.
Okay.
Of Washington.
Yeah. Fuck it, Basiago 2024. I believe him.
I believe him. Now there's a couple of things here for me. Now and Abe, you let me know. And Sheri too. If it was at one point benevolent, this program, something had gone awry by the time that he was sitting around when you had scumbags like Bushes and Clintons there.
Of course.
Which also brings me to the biggest question. when he says that we need at least limited use of this chronovision technology, who limits the use? He makes good points about why it can't be widespread, but who...
Sure, but bad actors are going to use the technology if they're not using it right now. If it was available, they're using it.
There has to be a battle. Who's getting the technology? There has to be a behind this constant struggle for this.
Right. Abe, you got to get your volume up a little bit.
Sorry, there has to be a battle for this knowledge, this technology, right? There has to be this underground constant freaking war.
That was going to be my question.
The good guys, right?
Yeah. Like, does our future depend on the amount of hijinks that current bad actors are perpetrating right now?
Dude, I have so many questions. I have so many questions written
down. And
is
Trump playing the same game? Like, that goes along with all the whole Q narrative. If there were a war going on behind the scenes, that would be it.
Here's the Courier and
trying
Ives.
To change the past.
Courier and Ives right there.
There's
Cousin Sheri just sent this to me right now. That you have Washington with his dream of liberty. But look, outside the door of his tent, where is he? Boom.
But there's two guys. There's another guy behind.
There's two guys.
Maybe they're just guys standing guarding.
It could be a boy.
Right. Yeah, it could be.
But, you know, who the hell knows? Looks like he has a tri-cornered hat on.
I love that idea.
Is his eye socket fuzzy?
No. Can't see him from this angle. Boy, oh boy. Okay. I got to get into these super chats. We got to clear them out, and then we're gonna take off. A lot of this stuff is going to be, oh, good. Oh, it's not that heavy a load. Captain Cast Iron says, I think they use museums because it's convenient. A lot of old shit when you go back and forth. And then he says,
a stage in Morristown?
That's what I'm talking about. That's why I was like, okay, well, why in community centers? Why on a stage? Why in museums? Why these public places? If this is so... And obviously, very secretive and high, world-changing technology. Why isn't it going to be in secure little bunkers? Why in elevator shafts and random buildings? I thought that's why. I thought it would have to have been a point of, okay, well, there's energy meridians all over the place, and we have to just have these jump rooms and these chronovisors right there where it could have some kind of a source to power it. But he says no. Ley lines exist, but that's not why they had them.
And it's perception. It's the perception of the person that's creating the portal that's where it ends up. That's what I kind of got from him.
Yeah.
So maybe like some guy really knows the stage at the Morristown Theater.
I bet we can go there one day.
That would be crazy.
Yeah, more timeless structure.
Yeah.
Wow.
My God. Okay, and now over on Pilled, PC Tech Pro, thank you. Witchy Poo started a cookie fight. Now, Daisy, hold on. I have to pause this. Here we go. Pudding Hollow, Daisy Chains. What else? Who else we have in there? Captain Cast Iron, wow, mind-blowing show, excellent guest. Matt 1776, that's the head honcho over there at Pilled. Great show tonight. Fuck, P-U-C-H, says Bravo Frank, another great interview, brilliant. Stickman Freediver says, did General George Washington ask, whence came ye? And then, I got all this stuff to talk about. Jay Brewski's Homegoy says, okay, that last one was a cookie. What the hell is this? Stickman Freediver again says, can you teleport all the illegal refugees back to their home countries? Homegoy again says, making up for all my free lurking. And now Witchy Poo 123 SKG, fascinating topic, he says, PC Tech. So everybody's having a good time there. I got to release the scratching. And is the scratching button still where it's supposed to be? I don't know. I think, oh, there you go. All right, so that just happened. Now let's go over to Rumble. Is anybody in Rumble? Everybody's having a good time, but there are no Rumble rants. That's easy. And then over on Rockfin, Twisted Wizard says, I would love to hear Chris Ann Hall's thoughts on the history he partook in. This is an awesome show. Well, this is the way I always wanted Friday and Saturday nights to be. Man.
Cool stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, good stuff. Now, Sheri, all the stuff that you have left over... You have to send to me.
All right.
And I'll keep it in with all the notes I've been taking. And I'm sure that there's going to be follow-ups. I'm going to have to listen to this myself.
There's stuff I got to look up. Strangely, a lot of coincidences with the places he mentioned in me. Mount Diablo, weird place. I've been there. Sandia Labs. I was there same year he was. Very weird.
Abe, on your end, too, I don't know if you're going to listen to this again. I'm going to tell, quite frankly, writer John Carroll to listen to this from start to finish and just jot down follow-ups all along the way just so that we have dozens of questions that will last us another couple of episodes. But
well, many times in the chat, I did ask if anyone was taking notes. And, you know, I think we should quiz the Franklies at the end. We should just have a quiz at the end of all the Basiago appearances. For fun.
Yeah.
We got prizes.
We do.
You got things to give away.
I know.
It might even be a Washington thing in there.
There could be.
No, I'm kidding. But I do think, I did get a feeling that there is no question you could not ask him that he would not have an answer for. So I'm really looking forward to future appearances because it does seem like this ties into just about everything.
Well, you know, what I really want to talk a little bit more about, like I said, Antarctica. That is a huge topic that he's got to know. Because there's so many overlapping themes with the Antarctica question, with ET technology, the Nazis that are on the run and secret bases. Obviously, there's got to be people that jump around. I want to know if he's still remote views. I want to talk about the 8 modalities of time jumping and remote viewing and all that.
Out-of-body experiences by just spinning people.
Yeah. Well, not only that, he talked about, didn't he poo-poo looking glass technology as we've heard it from people? I want to ask him about Bill Wood. Is that all nonsense or is it misunderstood? Because Bill Wood was he's done many interviews about looking glass technology, about how, you know, because looking glass is something where you peer into the future, but you can test certain.
Is that the one where they dropped a penny through it or something like
no,
that?
No. It's where you can test probability of outcome based on what your actions and what your thoughts are going to be.
Okay.
So, and Bill Wood was, he said very prophetically that those in control now, I guess the deep state, the black hats, whatever you want to call them, they had seen an irreversible, unavoidable change, a shift where not necessarily the world was going to end, but the power structures world was going to end, and that we're lurching towards something that's unavoidable, and it sounded like some sort of a great awakening.
Right,
and
right.
I want to be able to talk about that.
There are fixed points
yeah,
that we can see. Yeah,
I want to talk about
that.
Future forecasting.
Yeah.
You know, so there's so much stuff to do, and I think we had a great time here tonight. Sheri, before we leave, let everybody know how they can find. I know that you have a secondhand store. You have some great, so you're going to start doing auctions.
Right, going online. It's Whatnot. It's an app and it's a website, and my handle is Curiosity Shop, and I'm going to be doing my first live auction next Thursday at 9:15. So if you follow me, if you find Curiosity Shop on Whatnot, I could have some followers.
But you do what I love about what you do with the store is not only do you make a lot of things, but you are a really prolific finder of antiques,
cool stuff,
historical artifacts, relics. It's great, great stuff.
I curate my curious collection.
A lot of the stuff in this room,
right?
You know, cool stuff.
A lot of weird things.
Well,
so yeah, find me on Whatnot, Curiosity Shop.
Abe, anything you want to say as we end here?
Quitefrankly.tv for all things. Quite frankly, I think if you go on the page, you'll see that Pild is updated. Figure out a way that it's going to send you notifications. That's the way to always get a notification for all the off-air content that is not necessarily posted on any platform that is not Foxhole. So if you want some of that extra bonus stuff, make sure you're getting notifications from there.
Yeah, and you know what? Tonight is pretty much the crux of Quite Frankly.tv programming. I don't know if anything's going on afterwards, but tomorrow night, tomorrow night, Sunday night, we will have some good stuff that I'm going to pick for the 9 o'clock stream that usually goes well into the early morning, depending on what time zone you're in. And I hope you all come by to hang out with us. I will see you all on Monday evening, 7 p.m. The guest is Jason Burmis. We're talking about loose change behind the scenes all these years later. And I'm very happy to have had all of you here tonight. Thanks again, Sheri.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Andrew Basiago. Thanks, Aaron Moriarty, for the booking help. And Abe, you enjoy yourself over there wherever the hell you are.
Bye, Abe.
Bye.
Bye.
I'll catch you on the flip side.
Quite Frankly is filmed before a live studio audience, and now our super chatters, starting with Captain Cast Iron, and then a whole bunch of love on Foxhole, and Twisted Wizard on Rockfin. Thank you guys and gals for your time. I will not wait to see you all on Monday. Take care.